Can you give us an update, an overview first of just the number of hostages there are? How many have been released? How many do you still suspect does Hamas have?
So until now, in the last 4 days, as was agreed, we had actually 52 hostages that have been released, mostly women and their children. I have to say it's very difficult to hear when they leave behind them either elder brothers or fathers. So families were torn apart from that aspect. But on the other hand, at least part of the family was able to come back home. Except for those 52 Israelis, we had also, of course, as we know, one Filipino, Jimmy, who came back. And there were also 17 Thai workers who were released. We still have, and the numbers are, you know, it's an estimation of between 160 to 200 who are still held hostage in Gaza. We don't know their conditions, as was before. Nobody has seen them. The Red Cross was not able to visit those hostages. So this is the, I would say, the numbers that we are referring to currently now.
So the 52 hostages, the Israeli hostages were released, were all women and children. Was it intentional, you believe, on the part of Hamas to retain the men? Because a Filipino man was released. And I wanted to ask you, what about the Thai workers? Were they all male?
Well, from the Thai workers, there was one female, very famous, when she got back to, when she was released, part of their, it's a healing process. She got, you know, the manicure, pedicure and the haircut, and she was, you know, so happy finally. But there was one female, the rest were male. But from the Israeli side, the deal was, unfortunately, only children and the women that the Hamas was agreeing to release. Again, I'm not part of the, you know,
yes,
secret negotiations.
Of course.
But this was the agreement. And also from the Israeli side, we had to release women and children. And these children are usually teenagers who are prisoners who have been convicted of terrorism. So Israel, from our side, we released 150 women and children, prisoners who have been convicted for terrorism.
Okay, so the persons that Israel released were actually convicted in a court of law in Israel.
Correct, correct. That's the big difference.
Exactly. Yeah, that's a big difference. And did Hamas explicitly ask for that?
Well, you know, I'm basically when they just... The operation started after this terrible massacre. On the first week, one of the statements came from Hamas was that Hamas wants the release of all prisoners from Israeli jails. So that was, you know, a very general statement. And obviously, this is part of the Hamas efforts, is to release terrorists from Israeli jail, to become like national heroes of the Palestinians that are able to release the prisoners. But it is very important to say that these are prisoners that have been convicted. No one of them is a murderer, but they were involved in terror activities, if it is throwing stones, if it is stabbing, different kind of involvement in terror activities. But we, you know, there were negotiations, so it's difficult from here to put ourselves in the seats of the negotiators. But this was probably the best agreement we could achieve. And I have to say, you see the footage coming from Israel, and you see, you know, we had, of course, Jimmy, but also you see the Israelis coming back home, the families waiting for them. And, you know, some families were torn apart, some families, part of the families were murdered. So it gives some, I have to say, it gives some hope that for the fact to be reunited, and you see those pictures of, you know, of happiness, of, you know, children coming home surrounded by family, friends celebrating together, the two birthdays I think were celebrated. It really touches your heart.
Okay, all right. Now Ambassador, just going back to the hostages, I know there was an American hostage that was also freed, am I correct? One or two?
There was one hostage, which I'm not sure about the nationality, who was, I think, 22, 24. But generally speaking, some of the hostages that were released were dual nationalities, including French, I think, yesterday, including some US, Irish, I think, sort of. There were some dual nationalities that have been released.
Okay, let's talk about the truce. There's now an extension of this truce, and it could be anywhere from 4 to 9 days. Am I being accurate with the 9 days?
So it's important to say that it's not a truce. It's not a ceasefire. Okay. It is a pause. It is a pause in the war, in order to allow the return of hostages, in order to allow, and that's, we have to remember, one of the two goals of this war is the return of the hostages. The other one is to make sure Hamas cannot attack Israel ever again. But the first cause is, the first goal is to bring back the hostages. So this is a pause. And as long as we get back the hostages, the pause, to the best of my understanding, can be extended. For the time being, according to reports that I get, is that the pause has been extended in 2 days, meaning we are expecting 20 more be released in the coming 2 days. Every day is very complicated because, again, that's from what we read in the reports, the Hamas would release the list the day before of those that are going to be released at the morning. And those decisions and the list is very complicated, including they try to tear apart families and to release children without their mothers. And Israel has refused and put pressure to make sure that the families are not split, mothers are not left behind, or children are not left behind. So we still have children and mothers there, but you cannot, you know, tear apart the family. So it is a very complicated process. There are all kinds of internal currents and streams and issues that we are not privy of, but it makes it complicated, sensitive. We have a lot of involvement of the Americans, which is critical. Of course, Qatar and of course Egypt are all involved in the process.
All right. Now, you know, I've spoken with you in the beginning of this war, and you had Western nations, allies, supporting Israel and saying it has the right to defend itself. But I would have to say, maybe a few weeks after, with the intensity of Israel's attack on Gaza, you had the same Western leaders coming out asking Israel for a ceasefire and to already stop. And this is where I would have to say there's a change in our discussion. In the recent UN General Assembly, I know that the Israeli representative was quite adamant and emotional and really stressed that after the pause, Israel will go back to eliminating Hamas. So the war goes on, right, Ambassador? What happens after this pause?
So, Karen, it is very important to understand, October 7 did not disappear. Having a pause doesn't mean October 7 didn't happen. Israel was brutally attacked by the Hamas. We have to remember again, the Hamas is a terror organization which is calling for the annihilation of the state of Israel, for the destruction of the state of Israel, and for murdering of Jews. And this war has two goals. One is to release the hostages that were kidnapped illegally from Israel, held hostage. And this is exactly what's happening now. This is why we have a pause. Hopefully Hamas would realize that this is a better way to interact and will continue to release the hostages. Then we are responding in the same way and we are pausing the war. However, we have to remember that the second goal of this war is to make sure that the Hamas, which has a very clear agenda and is not changing its agenda and is not recognizing the state of Israel and still continues in its ideology, then we have to make sure this cannot happen again, because we had this cycle of violence since 2007, every 2 years, until to the escalation of October 7, which no responsible government can allow to happen again. So in a way, we have here optimistic days, and we're seeing really happy moments of uniting families and hostages that are returning home, finally getting all the treatment they need and all the love they need. However, this cannot continue forever. Depends on the Hamas. Depends if the Hamas will release all the hostages and will end its violence. We will continue the war until this will happen. Unfortunately, we know the footage is difficult, but we, again, as I explained to you, Karen, before, we have no choice. It doesn't look good, but we have no choice. The Hamas is hiding, and we have seen all the footage and in the hospitals, in the bunkers, in the tunnels, and the hospitals, in the mosques, in schools. So it is really a complicated time, and it's a complicated war, and we're trying to do the best to mitigate, to minimize the damage and harming civilians that are uninvolved. But Hamas is integrated into the society there.
You've said Hamas is integrated into the society there. And I'm sure you've heard the United Nations call of, even during war, there are rules. And we've seen horrific videos of children in Gaza dying as a result of this war, the hospitals being bombed. I know that Israel has called for the residents to go south or to move away from where the bombing is, but you've heard Queen Rania's call. Who is Israel speaking to when there's no electricity, no internet in Gaza? She says, you're speaking to the world and not the locals.
Well, Karen, if we heard the locals speaking against Hamas, it would be different. Maybe we have to remember, when the Hamas took the hostages and the regular Palestinian in the street in Gaza was cheering and playing with the bodies and with the heads of those innocent people that were murdered. So the Palestinians have voted for a Hamas government, and they're supporting a Hamas government, and they're cheering them. So I'm sure there are also innocent people who are not supporting Hamas, or even if they are supporting Hamas, they're not actively involved. However, they have elected Hamas, they're cheering, they're supporting them. So what do you expect when you have incitement, when you have teachings of anti-Semitism, when you have teachings of murdering Israelis and Jews, and you see footage of the summer camps in Gaza, which is teaching children to stab, to kill, to explode themselves on people. This is what they learn in summer camps. So you ask yourself, and I totally agree with the Queen Rania, who do we have to talk to? It's a very good question. And for this, we need our allies from the Arab world, from the global community, to work with us together to make sure that things change within the Palestinian population. Maybe one point which is important to correct. Israel has never bombed the hospital. You mentioned that they were bombing. We were bombing terror infrastructure. The hospitals, we get very special, very careful treatment, which put in risk our soldiers. We never bombed the hospital.
Okay, let's talk about Al-Shifa. Go ahead.
Yeah. So exactly, Al-Shifa is a perfect example where we very carefully, very slowly, within a few weeks, until IDF entered into Shifa, you would say we took away the element of surprise. The terrorists, the Hamas activists, had time to evacuate, not to be there. However, it was a hospital. We brought in petrol, gas. We brought in medical aid. The troops that came in at the first, when they entered, we had medics. We had Arabic-speaking troops. We talked to the patients, to the doctors. We brought with us incubators. We helped them evacuate if they wanted to evacuate. We recommended they do. And they evacuated willingly. A lot of them evacuated willingly. So, and then we entered into Shifa Hospital, and we have footage and all the evidence of the bunkers and systems and weapons and even some remains in the bunkers from the hostages themselves who were there for a certain amount of time, including footage of, I think, Nepali and Thai, who were brought into the hospital, probably later on moved to somewhere else. So this is cynical, that the Hamas is using this humanitarian infrastructure to remind us. Also ambulances that were used by Hamas for their activities, for the transport of themselves and transport of hostages. So this is a very complicated situation, and it's very, I would say, we have to be very careful with this, with the statements of what we are saying, because we are talking about a terror organization, not a responsible government. Even we have to ask ourselves, are the figures that are coming out from the Ministry of Health of Gaza, which is actually a Ministry of Health of Hamas? Maybe one last point. Now, during the time of the pause, except for the release of the hostages, there's a lot of humanitarian aid which is coming into Gaza. Mm. Hundreds of trucks. Can they even, if they're describing this damage and that everything is totally ruined, how can they even absorb all this humanitarian aid? But we are coordinating with the UN, and humanitarian aid is coming in, food, medical supplies, energy, things are coming in, and of course, shelter. So we are assisting in all the humanitarian needs into Gaza, assisting it to come in into Gaza to be able to be used for the benefit of the people. Of course, conditions are not good. Absolutely, nobody denies that. But we have to understand who is the good here and who is the bad. And the Hamas is evil.
All right. Okay. Now, it could be a much more historical discussion. This is not the show or the time for that right now. But let's move on to this. So you have aid coming into Gaza. This pause allows the aid to come in. But after that, war resumes. The target of Israel is Hamas. And hopefully by that time, most of the residents have already evacuated, correct? That is, but if they're integrated into the local society, how could Israel still find Hamas? There are tunnels there. I mean, I know some of this information could be, it's very confidential, but who will Israel be at war with?
Well, when
there's
I think
nothing left there.
Well, Karen, it's not that there's nothing left. There's a lot of destruction. As long as the Hamas is hiding and taking and uses residential buildings, schools. So I think these questions have to be addressed actually to the Hamas, maybe to Iran, to the Palestinian Authority. How can they put in order what's happening in Gaza in order to allow Israel to sit back and to say, okay, our safety is being taken care of. We can end this war. But nobody is doing it. And this is why we have to do it. Until October 7, we were hoping that exactly as you are saying, economy is better, they're working in Israel, there are different projects, and due to the improvement of standard of living, there will be some pragmatism and we'll be able to live side by side. Mm-hmm. However, we have been fooled. And we cannot be fooled once again. And I think the pressure has to go on the Hamas. Now, if the war will start again, we're going to see again very difficult footage. The IDF has, again, its ways in order to minimize the damage to civilian infrastructure and, of course, to the civilians, to the people. This is our obligation according to the international law. But and we are fulfilling this obligation, but we have to remember, maybe the citizens of Gaza should put pressure on Hamas to move away from the homes, to move away from the hospitals. Maybe the UN has to put the pressure on those operatives to keep away from their facilities, to evacuate those tunnels and go and fight Israel. We know that now the Hamas is in southern part of Gaza. So if the war will continue, again, I am not part of, of the plans, but unfortunately, it might take a long time, and we have patience, will continue as we did the operations until now. It was slow, but we did it in a careful way, trying to minimize, of course, loss of Israeli soldiers and loss of civilians, lives of civilians.
Ambassador, it's very difficult for many to speak about the war without going to the root cause of it. So you have the world essentially going on protest. You've seen it, footage coming from many countries all over the world asking to free Palestine. So the root cause of this, which is the occupation of the West Bank, the property of Palestine in effect, or the jurisdiction, the territories getting smaller, as they say, the Jewish settlers invade certain areas that are meant to be for Palestinians. I mean, Gaza is a situation wherein you're right. They voted, they elected for Hamas. Israel has left the Gaza Strip. But it all boils down to, even Queen Rania has said it, the root cause of this all is the occupation. Is what about the respect? Is a two-nation state still possible?
So, you know, we're hearing what Queen Rania was saying, but I tend to differ. Okay. We started the Oslo process, mm-hmm. where from having nothing, we established the Palestinian Authority. We had different initiatives to get into mutual recognition and to some kind of a political final agreement mm-hmm. between the two sides. Mm-hmm. We gave up because the Palestinians always turned back to terrorism. And it happened in 96, it happened in 2000, the Intifada. I mean, we have so many terror attacks against Israelis, unfortunately. In 2005, we said, okay, we'll do it unilaterally, and we disengaged and we pulled out of Gaza, moving out 9,000 of the Jewish settlers in Gaza. And that led us to a state of Hamas. So I think that the root cause is recognition and respecting the right of Israel to exist safely and securely in their homeland. And this is lacking from the international conversation. And when you hear the slogans, a Palestinian state from the river to the sea, in some of those demonstrations that you see globally, then really we feel very worried. The Jews were persecuted for so many centuries, and this persecution suddenly is waking up once again, and it's becoming not only between Israel and the Palestinians, and you see anti-Semitism coming out from places which are shocking, from campuses, and you see these big demonstrations. Yes, it is worrying, but I have to say, on the other hand, we're seeing leaders that are standing firm behind Israel, because I think October 7 is exactly a turning point where we understand it's not about occupation. It's about the right of Israel to exist, and the Hamas and Islamic Jihad. And you never heard from the Palestinian Authority one word of condemnation, one word of sympathy with Israel. No. And that's so worrying, because since 1948, 1956, 1967, 1973, you name it, there's only one state today in the world which is very existent, is still being threatened and not recognized, and that's Israel. And you have to realize that in order to have an end to this situation, you have to give the assurances for the safety and security of the state of Israel. And until this happens, we simply have to do it unilaterally or with the support of our allies, and we have to build a strong Israeli defense forces. And that's the title. These are defense forces that are defending the state of Israel, sometimes from wars by states, as happened before. And in the new time today, unfortunately, modern time today, we're defending from terror organizations like Hamas, like Islamic Jihad. And we have to remember the financer, the supporter, which is Iran, which has exactly the same agenda.
Okay. Now, what is, just quickly, the difference? I mean, you have Israel, the only Jewish state. You are surrounded by Arab nations, and yet you live at peace with Egypt, with Jordan, with Saudi Arabia. In fact, talks were supposed to resume right? And just very quickly, what happened to those talks? Are you still pushing through with the talks?
So maybe I'll just add, we have, of course, Egypt and Jordan, and Egypt is taking a key role in the negotiations now. We have peace relations with Bahrain, with the United Arab Emirates, with Morocco, and these are, I mean, there's no interruption there. With the Saudis, of course, the Saudis are part of the Arab and Muslim world, and they support for the Palestinians. But on the other hand, we hear also statements that that these quiet talks would be resumed. Of course, now is not the time to resume direct negotiations, but we're hearing very clear statements of positions. These discussions, you know, a negotiation would not be done here through the media, but we hear from them very clear desire to continue when it would be the right time.
So, Ambassador, the question is, if Israel is able to live at peace with its Muslim neighbors, what is the difference with the Palestinians?
I totally agree. I think the Palestinians have to take an example and to become pragmatic. And that's the thing. Number one...
But the difference then would be occupation, right?
One minute. But no. The issue is, first of all, recognition. Recognition of the right of Israel to exist safely. Then we move to discuss giving security assurances that Israel is safe. And then we can discuss territory. There were different solutions. The reality since 1967 has changed. And we have to look into those changes and work together to have a pragmatic solution, which will answer the needs of both sides. However, we don't see a pragmatic leadership on the Palestinian side who is able to lead a political process as we expect leaders to do. And I think that's one of the challenges on the Palestinian side, from Egypt, from Jordan, UAE, Saudi, you name it. There is leadership, pragmatic leadership, that understands why it's better to look to the future and not to be busy only with the fighting and wars of the past. Until the Palestinians don't change the mindset, don't look to the future, and are busy fighting the wars of the past, these wars of the past are, unfortunately, the wars of now.
Okay. Ambassador, how does Israel respond to calls, to accusations that Israel, the Jewish people, once a victim of genocide, is now committing genocide against the Palestinian people? Israel's attacks are compared to committing genocide, to murder.
Karen, I you know, this question is something which I'm shocked when I read and I see some of those people are using this word. You have to understand what is genocide. It is a legal term. And who is doing genocide here is the Hamas. Israel is fighting a war. Israel has no desire to murder Palestinians. And I don't want to use this word, because this is not what we are doing. The Jews and the Israelis are moral people that are standing for moral values. We are contributing to the world in many, many ways. We have no desire to kill Palestinians. And as I explained before, we take a lot of precautions in order to avoid civilian casualties. Of course, it is in a war, and the war has laws, and we are working accordingly. And the war in this case is a terror organization. It's not an army. And we have to remember what happened when they were fighting in Afghanistan, in Iraq, you know, the Al-Qaeda and ISIS, ISIS here in the Philippines. Unfortunately, in a war like this against a terror organization, which is using human shield, and that's a crime war, then the reality is very complicated. The footage is very difficult. However, we're fighting a just fight and a just war against the forces of evil in order to protect the good. And if we had a reliable, strong, positive partner, would have been able to change the interaction, and they would have been changed the Middle East altogether. It started. Oslo has proven to be failed, and we need a new leadership on the Palestinian side to be able to discuss with us What kind of future solutions and how can we live together?
Yeah, that's very interesting. So to close after your points, the world's response is what they call the appropriateness. What they question is the appropriateness of Israel's response, right? You've heard this. Is Israel's defense appropriate? Is it too much? Is it beyond defense? In fact, you, just quoting from Queen Rania, who's been speaking in all international agencies, she said it's an insult to the intelligence to say that Israel's actions are a matter of defense. So with that and my last questions, what happens next to Gaza? After Israel has wiped out Hamas with the destruction of Gaza, what would Israel do? So perhaps you can close by having both in one thought.
Well, let me just say that you're quoting Queen Rania, who is Palestinian, and I totally, you know, sympathize and understand. But let's remember, let's quote President Biden, let's quote Boris Johnson, or never mind. I mean, we have so many other leaders who are still visiting and who are strongly supporting Israel. And believe me, they understand what are these legal terms. When we're talking about proportionality, we're not talking about Israel coming back into Gaza, and we would then kill between 12 to 1400 civilians, children, babies, women, ladies, exactly in the same way that Hamas did to us. This is not proportionality, because we're not targeting civilians and Hamas is targeting civilians. We're doing our best to avoid it. The proportionality is between the military action and the results expected out of this military action and how much we're doing in order to mitigate and minimize civilian casualties. So it's very different. When we talk about proportionality, it's very, very different, and we have to understand what we are talking about. Secondly, I would say that we hope to see less destruction in Gaza as much as possible, but that depends on the Hamas, depends on the pressure that the international community, if it is here from the Philippines, if it is from the States, from many other countries, to put pressure on Iran and to put pressure on Hamas and to put pressure on Palestinian Authority to move away from terrorism, to recognize the right of Israel to exist. So we are in a pause now. And I would say my really hope is out of this pause, first of all, to see all those that have been kidnapped illegally into Gaza by Hamas return home, or each one of them. And that's the first goal. If it is through this pause and exchange, and if not, of course, we'll have to, unfortunately, go back to fighting. And secondly, make sure that Gaza is not again a home base for Hamas to attack Israel. It can be done militarily, but you know, you can find a mechanism how Hamas can move away somewhere else and not bothering Israel and not threatening again Israel. How to do it? That's very complicated, but that's another option. But we have to understand, Israel cannot allow this to happen again and cannot, as a responsible government, cannot accept having Hamas arm itself and build again this terror infrastructure and attack Israel once again in a couple of years' time.
On that note, I want to thank you for joining me this morning. Israel Ambassador to the Philippines, Ilan Flas. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you very much.